very, very well. And for Mark, I'm very excited to do this, and I must welcome you, and I'm very happy you're here. And also, I would love everyone afterward to come outside, and we have a wonderful terrace to sit and have drinks.
It's beautiful upstairs. You have to go upstairs after Mark gives his talk, and thank you so much, Andy.
Maybe this could be a regular salon.
But first, Andy, would you introduce your very dear friend?
Oh,
he's going to introduce our guest.
The guest or Peter?
Peter.
Oh, Peter happens to be one of my husband's very dear friends and something buddy.
Welcome everybody to this common good event. Special thanks for Andy Stark. I had a choice of going to play golf in Ireland for 4 days or doing this tonight. I elected to do this. So thank you very much for having us in your beautiful home. But I happen to know the truth. This is not their home, really. This is their main showroom. Stark Carpet. That's what this really is. So, but thank you very much, Andy. So, I asked Patricia, who's always helpful to me, you know, to what I should talk about. She said, try to think about something interesting. I said, thank you very much. And then I went and made some remarks. So let's talk first.
And brief.
So first of all, the Common Good is a great organization. You should understand, or I hope you understand, how very hard Patricia works to put all these things together. And it is not only a nonprofit organization, it is really nonprofit, isn't it? It's really nonprofit. So a lot of thanks to Patricia, who takes not only this event, but many other events. And in looking at some of the things in the bio, Patricia, one of the things that I found out today that I never knew before is you have a very big background in assassinations, which is where you started your career. And so I'm going to be a lot nicer to you now that I know that. So I wrote down some stuff. The freedom of speech, important topics. These are the kinds of things that are so important for all of us Americans to consider the way things are happening today. Words that I've written down like commitment, hard work. Mark Ruffalo, who I'm going to introduce in a second, is part of that epic. People who make a difference work very hard to do that. So having said that about Patricia, I wrote down some notes here on because I wrote found out some things with Mark. And
we thought it was God speaking.
I'm going to start over. we became friendly through Patricia and met Mark Ruffalo, who is on his way from becoming from star to superstar, and we're very pleased that he's been able, in his busy schedule, to take the time to participate and lead this event on alternative, or what we call energy solutions, and try and solve these fracking energy problems. My family, especially my daughter, supports everything that Mark does. Mark happens to live up in the country near where we live, in a place called Calicoon. He moved up there. I guess what I wrote down was he was thinking about moving to Buffalo, but he didn't want any rhyming in the introduction. Buffalo from Calicoon.
Shuffle off the Buffalo.
Yeah, the other is. So we really appreciate you being here, Mark. I found out one thing, and I'm going to be a really good friend. I didn't know you spent 9 years being a bartender since I found out.
You and I, we're really we got a date, don't we? Okay.
So having said that, please, a big round of applause for all of you.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Andrew Stark, for having us. Thank you for this job, for putting this together and being such a nice friend to us. I guess quickly, this is a big subject, and We're doing a lot. We're asking a lot, and it's bold what we're trying to do. I'm going to quickly tell you. About 4 years ago, I moved to upstate New York. I have three children and my wife, and I was there, and I heard about this incredible new thing that was going to make us energy independent, that was going to bring all of our kids home from the wars. It was going to save climate change. It was going to be cheap, and it was going to be American. It was going to save farmers. It was going to save our economy. And I thought that was great, and I thought that was reasonable. So I started to look into it. It's called hydrofracking. I thought it was the greatest thing since sliced bread, honestly. And so I started to look into it, and I started to hear some troubling things. People's wells were being poisoned. And it wasn't just one place, it was happening all over the place. And then there was an EPA whistleblower who came out around that time who was saying that the EPA was hiding information on this particular methodology of extraction. Now, does everyone know what fracking is? Should I give you a quick primer?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Fracking is a way to extract natural gas. There's supposedly an enormous amount of natural gas trapped in a somewhat porous material called shale. And that material lives about 5,000 feet below the surface of the earth. And about 40 years ago, they came up with an idea to blast water down these holes and break around the bedrock to let gas and, at the time, thereafter, oil. Now, this is T. Boone Pickens' big thing. But what's happened in the past 10, 12, 15 years is a whole nother animal. It's called slick water, high volume, hydraulic, horizontal fracturing. Hydraulic fracturing. And what they do is they drill 5,000 feet down, and then they drill 5,000 feet out. They'll do up to 16 spokes off a well, which sounds very economic. You have one hole and many, many wells drilled off of it. And then when they drill down, they blast water into that well. And they create so much pressure using diesel engines to actually crack the bedrock 5,000 feet below the surface of the earth. Now, their industry says it's about 15,000 pounds per square inch. You can imagine the amount of force you need to create to crack bedrock 5,000 feet below the surface of the earth. When it cracks the bedrock, it creates little explosions, and fissures are created. And the water moves into these fissures and these small pockets where gas is. And it releases the gas, and the gas starts to percolate to the surface. And that's how they capture the gas. What's happening is a few things. When you create that kind of pressure, 10% of these well casings are failing. I'm getting that from the industry's information. 10% are failing. The gas is, the methane gas is migrating into aquifers and into people's homes. So when you see the guy turning on his faucet and lighting his water on fire, that's methane migration from hydraulic fracturing. The other thing that's happening is there's veins of water all under us all the time. It's like a leaf. When you look at the maps, the water aquifers that are under our feet are like the veins in a leaf. They're everywhere, and they're very fine to very, very, very big. And people believe that these plumes are coming up, that this water that's been injected with 560 chemicals. Now, some of these chemicals are known to be cancerous. They need these chemicals to either kill bacteria in these wells, to make the water slicker, to allow the gas to escape. There's glues in there to hold the fissures open so that the gas can escape. There's antibiotics in there. There's ethyl glycol in there. The list goes on and on and on. A big one that they use is benzene. And that's a major cancer-causing substance. substance compound, and it's ending up in aquifers. Now, the other thing is after they drill, it's between 5 and 16 million gallons of water that are tainted with 150,000 gallons of these chemicals. Now, they'll do, that's for one spoke. They can do that 16 times off of a well. Now, what you have to, there's many different aspects to this that we have to remember. One of them is they have to use fresh water. They can't use salt water. It has to be fresh water. 2.5% of the water on the planet is fresh water. That's all the fresh water we've ever had. That's all the fresh water there will ever be. We are looking at using trillions upon trillions of gallons of fresh water to hydrofrack. We're talking about doing that in the face of climate change. Now, I'm assuming that you, a lot of you are well enough educated to believe that climate change is actually happening. The IEA says that if we continue on the International Energy Agency, if we continue on the use of carbon the way we're doing today, we have 5 years before it's too late, before we enter an echo chamber of carbon release and ice caps melting, which was allowing more carbon to be released into the atmosphere. This is a carbon-based fuel that we're bringing up. For a long time, I believed that it burned cleaner than coal, but now we found out that it's just as bad as coal. We're finding out that that to change our infrastructure to a gas infrastructure, which is what T. Boone Pickens is pushing for, what America is talking about when we say energy independence, that's $700 billion to change out the infrastructure from a coal-burning infrastructure to a gas infrastructure, from a gasoline infrastructure to a natural gas infrastructure. The president said in the State of the Union address that we have 100 years of natural gas underneath us right now. The U.S. Geological Service revised that to 20 years at the current consumption of natural gas today. We are going to build out a $700 billion infrastructure for 20, maybe 25 years of gas, which is only going to aggravate the climate change problems that we're facing today. It's insanity. So, 3 years ago, I realized we've entered another era. We've entered the era of extreme energy extraction. No longer do we stick a straw in the ground and get beautiful concentrated carbon bubbling to the surface. Now we have hydraulic fracturing, deep water drilling, tar sands, mountaintop removal. All of these methods of extracting carbon are incredibly energy intensive, and all of them destroy fresh water, except for deep sea drilling. But we see what that does. Okay, that destroys entire ecosystems. What I am suggesting, and what Water Defense is trying to do, is to leap over the idea of natural gas altogether. The question is, we could go back and forth, is this great for our country, is it not? The real question is, if we're serious about climate change, we've got to leap over it and go directly to renewables, and that's what I've been working on. I started fighting hydrofracturing, and it opened up an entire knowledge to me. We have the technology today to actually do it. I've been working with the leading people in the field of renewable energy. How you doing? You're late. I'm going to start over so he gets it. Anyway, that's the very wordy version of what I've been up to. We've been building, since I started this, we've stopped hydrofracking in New York State. We've had a moratorium in place for 4 years that we were very instrumental in putting together. I went to the Capitol building with Pete Seeger the day they were going to vote, and we got him to push through the moratorium. I talked to Governor Patterson hours before he pushed through the moratorium. The Governor Cuomo has been pushing this forward, saying he's going to rely on the science, but every day new damning science comes out on this. Earthquakes, it causes earthquakes. They said for a long time that no well has ever been, we've never proven that a well has been contaminated by hydrofracking. Well, we have it now in Wyoming. 2 months ago, in Pavilion, Wyoming, the EPA found that wells were actually contaminated by hydrofracking. But what I'm saying is, and there's a lot of different views about this, but let's start thinking proactively about our future and our children's future. 2 days ago, Saudi Arabia committed $100 billion to solar power. The head of the oil ministry said, we're doing this because we know extraction doesn't produce jobs. Think about that. It's not just Saudi Arabia going after jobs. Saudi Arabia's had unemployment for 14-20% for the last 20 years. They don't care about jobs. What are they really saying about that? It's easy to extrapolate from that statement that they know we're at the end of the line of carbon. And not a moment too soon. I am grateful to the oil and gas industry for giving us 70 years of cheap concentrated carbon that has given us the Industrial Revolution and the Technological Revolution. But now it's time for us to evolve into the new Industrial Revolution, which is renewable energy. It's the fastest growing job sector in the United States. We went from $800 million in trade last year in that sector to $1.8 billion in 1 year. It's the fastest growing, it's the best paying, it's what's going to put our people back to work, and that's where the jobs is at, not the drill. We've been lied to with this drill thing. They want to export this out of the country. Right now, gas is at the lowest it's been in 20 years, and a little bit over a dollar per 1,000 cubic feet, and it's time for us, people like you, to start to shift our thinking on carbon and move to a renewable energy policy. And we can start here in New York State with Governor Cuomo. He has this huge problem on his hands, which is hydrofracking. He doesn't want this. It's a disaster waiting to happen, and it's going to happen on his watch. He did the right thing on marriage equality. And now he has the rights, and now our president is following his lead on marriage equality, and now he has the chance to do it on renewable energy. Don't be fooled. The technology is there. Every other country in the world is leaving us behind, and the oil and gas industry wants to mire us down to wring every last dollar out of us. They have no nationalist interests. Their interests are only their bottom line. That's why we're paying out the nose for gasoline right now. If they cared about this country, they would stop bilking us when they're making every single year record profits. If they cared about this country, think about it. They would give us a hand. And that's all I have to say.
I have to tell you, this morning, T. Boone Pickens was on television advocating how good the United States would be if we weren't oil dependent. It's all propaganda. It is all propaganda. I agree with you. I understand fracking. I'm very involved with the environment. And great kudos to you, because you have brought this issue right to the front.
And 100,000 other people.
I know.
It's a very powerful grassroots movement.
Like snowballing.
Yes. It's the biggest, probably biggest environmental movement in the past 30 years in the States. Yes, sir.
Question. Renewable energy. How quickly will renewable energy take over for the fossil fuel?
Right now, I've been working with Professor Mark Jacobson from Stanford. He's the leading civil engineer in the United States, and I would argue probably one of the top in the world, at one of the greatest colleges in the world. He has a plan to get us completely to renewable energy by 2030. This is in our kids' lifetime. This is in, my God, it's in your lifetime.
Okay, you'll live longer than that. You'll live a lot longer.
The question
you'll be driving an electric car.
Most fossil fuels go for transportation. It's a waste.
Right.
It's a tremendous waste.
That's right.
I mean, this has been admitted years ago. I was in those Exxon people in Japan on a bus, and they said the biggest waste of oil is in the automobile industry.
That's right. They only get 20%.
It should be used in a chemical really for the feedstock. But the question is how. I was involved in some methane things out of the garbage dumps and all this stuff.
Biodigestion.
And the question is, we use a lot of fuel. You say renewable fuels, forgetting what the professor says. In reality, we're a very large economy.
That's right.
Very dependent on this fossil fuel.
That's right.
You're not going to eliminate it in 10 years or 20 years.
Maybe 30.
Okay. And the question is, I know solar power and all this, I have clients involved in it. But when the clouds come or the wind stops, and then we have Cape Cod, where they wanted to put up the windmills, and the Kennedys and everyone said, absolutely not in our backyard.
Right.
How are you going to get renewable energy really in this country if powerful interests or wealthy people say, not in my backyard?
That's a great question. First, I'm going to go back a little bit. There is a misconception about renewable energy that we're talking wind, water, and solar now. That is the makeup that you'd have to have. So when the sun isn't shining, the wind is blowing. When the wind isn't blowing, the sun is shining, or the water or geothermal is actually, and geothermal is another piece of it, and the water is running. That's what Marc Jacobson has done so well. I'll put it in the context for you. To power the entire fleet, automotive fleet in the United States, a solar farm the size of Rhode Island would be required.
The King Ranch in Texas.
The entire United States, exactly.
Yeah.
The Mojave Desert. This is not... The industry has pushed this idea that we're not there, that it will never be, that it cannot be. I am saying, let's start to think bolder. We are facing the greatest enemy in the history of mankind, and that is climate change. And I don't care how much money you have, there's no way you're going to be able to run when it starts coming down. There's no place to hide. And we are at a moment now where we can go with some grace. We're at the end of carbon. I mean, the days are gone. Look at how we're getting this stuff now, right? We're going to have to make a choice, and we're going to go. We're either going to go kicking and screaming, or we're going to go with some grace and some foresight and some will. But we're going. The writing's on the wall. The Saudis know it. That's why they're investing. The Saudis have a completely 100% renewable
seed. The Saudis also want to be independent, and they have a problem. They export that oil. If other countries don't buy that oil, they've got to have another source. And renewable energy is so it's not just simply a simple thing. There's a lot of politics involved in the Saudi decision.
Sure, but we have to start somewhere with some vision.
Let me do another question.
I'd love to keep talking to you. You're bright, and I love Bobby.
I know, moving the solar and wind and the rest would be great, but I think we also need to think about transitional efforts. And one of the problems we have today, particularly when we're talking about transportation fuel, as you were talking, is that we've sort of got this chicken and egg situation, in that the auto manufacturers today only build automobiles in the United States. They do differently in other countries, but in the United States, they only build automobiles that can run on gasoline. Okay? But we have alternative fuels. Alternative liquid fuels, that in fact the same cars they sell here burn outside this country, in Brazil and China and other places. The cars they build here could, with just this tiny adjustment, run on either ethanol or methanol or a variety of other non-petroleum sourced liquid fuels and non-food sourced liquid fuels. But we have a problem in that there's chicken and egg. The auto manufacturers aren't going to build these cars unless these alternative fuels are available. And nobody's going to go through the innovation and the entrepreneurial process of building the, of getting these fuels delivered unless somebody builds the cars first. Now, in Congress, there is the Open Fuel Standard Act that's been proposed that would require automotive vehicle manufacturers to produce cars that are capable of running on non-petroleum fuels, which would essentially solve this chicken and egg problem. Because we finally, once the cars are there, all kinds of people would say, my God, I can make a ton of money by producing non-petroleum, non-fossil fuels for these cars. Okay, have you guys considered, things like that as ways to get us off the fossil fuels?
There's a transition that will be made, but look at Israel. Israel's putting 100,000 electric cars on their roads in the next 3 years. It's smart. It's a smart thing to do because the efficiency that you get from an electric car is almost 99%. When you run a power plant to get it, your efficiency is so much higher than when you're putting these other things in your car. Now, ethanol has its problems, we have food shortages in the world. Honestly, we don't need it. We could start putting electric cars on the road today, tomorrow. It's already happening. Listen, I'm not suggesting a political coup. This is all coming from the bottom up. We're already almost at parity right now. If you back out the subsidies that the oil and gas industry gets, and you back out the interest that we have to spend for defense to protect these oil lines and things throughout the world, we're already paying $20 a gallon of gas. We just don't know it. Once you start backing out the externalities of healthcare, of mitigation, of remediation, then you start seeing what we're paying for energy and that these other forms are actually already at parity or cheaper. But this is the conversation that we need to have. It's not a conversation we want to have, but it's a conversation that we can have now. We have the technology to do this stuff. This is not like some space-age George Jetson stuff I'm talking about. This is happening, and it's like the computer industry. Exponentially, every year, it's doubling, and it's moving very quickly. And they're doing it in other places of the world. And there's no reason that we can't be part of it.
Richard Wolf here today. I'm so happy to see you. Fantastic author.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Journalist.
You are fantastic.
From MSNBC. So thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you for being here.
Any other questions?
Well, I just wanted to say one thing to this gentleman that had the chicken and the egg and which came first, whatever. If we don't solve these energy problems, there'll be no chickens and no eggs.
I wish I came up with that. we're going out, you and me.
And over here with Paula and Ben right here.
Mark, I love your passion, and it sounds like you and the organization have had great success so far, at least in New York. Could you just tell us a little bit more about what's happening at a national level, your organization perhaps coordinating with others, mm-hmm. and also what role, if any, courts and the litigation is starting to move this along.
Glad you asked that. Okay. We just rolled out Natural Gas Exposed, which is an education. We're only getting one side of the story. Now, you can't forget that when you see the Exxon guy come out in his commercial, or the Shell commercial, telling us how great natural gas is, they're selling you something. It's a commercial. It's not a public service announcement. They're not imparting some wisdom on you that is been given to them because they want to give it to you out of the kindness of their heart or because of the common good. They're selling you gas. They want to sell you on it, okay? So, who's filling the void of the education? There's scientists running around all over the place screaming at the top of their lungs. No one can hear them. Mainstream media won't pick it up. These people have millions upon millions of dollars, but there's stories. There's some people whose lives have been affected. And those are the people that people need to hear from. Those are the people that move people. And so we've been doing a campaign, an online campaign, to educate people about natural gas with scientists, with real geologists, with real scientists who aren't employed by Exxon or Shell. That's one thing we're doing. We were key in the tar sands protests. We've been working with 350.org and the climate change movement. We're doing a national day of action where people can do, instead of, I realized at some point, it's not enough to fight something. You got to come up with a solution. You have to come up with an alternative that makes sense, that's doable. And we're here, we're at that place. People know climate change is happening. They have tornadoes ripping through their homes. They have the, you know, in upstate New York, we've had the 50-year flood, the 100-year flood, the 200-year flood, and the 500-year flood in the past 10 years. That's not natural. And so all of a sudden, it's not an abstract anymore. It's happening to people. And they're making the connections everywhere. So that's the other thing. We're doing a National Day of Action on renewable energy. And we're getting people to come in and tell their stories. What else are we doing?
What is the National Day of Action?
We actually haven't announced it yet, so you're getting kind of a sneak peek. But as Marcus said, we've realized again and again, first in starting in organizing in New York, that we were coming up against this question of, well, if not natural gas, then what? And we're not scientists or lawyers, and we don't profess to have all the answers. But we do want to have an honest conversation. And we've seen that the poll numbers show that regardless of what you think about fracking or natural gas, whether you're inclined to believe an oil company or an environmentalist, that everyone can agree on renewables. And everyone is looking for a better way to power the economy. So we see ourselves primarily as messengers who want to help people imagine something very bold that we know we need to undertake. And let's, at the very least, start our goals at what we think is necessary, not just what we think is politically possible. You know, why is it that we can imagine a new kind of cell phone service coming to our neighborhoods, or a new kind of phone service, new kind of internet, but we have this learned pessimism when it comes to energy? We can't envision a slightly more rational way of traveling and turning on the lights every day. So we're going to do a big distributed day of action. We haven't announced it yet, but we will very soon, where we want to both shine the light on natural gas as a bridge fuel to nowhere, and also shine the light of renewables and call for what Mark calls the sunlight revolution to get underway.
This problem is not only there for the USA, obviously, it's all over the world. Especially in South America, they are beginning now to drill and to do all the wars, and we know that the Arabian countries are doing, I read The Crude Oil by Peter Musk, which is enough. It's a big problem for everybody, so why don't you post a cause that we can click and send everywhere and sign a petition, for example, for Cuomo in this particular moment. So we can spread it through Facebook.
Yes. Waterdefense.org is up right now with that very thing. We have a petition for Cuomo.
You have a petition for Cuomo?
Yes, it's
so
up.
So we can sign it right.
Yes, you're an important people. I'm shaking in my boots being here with you. I feel way out of my league. If it makes any sense to you, we're humbly coming to you for your help, honestly. And your ideas, you are the cream of the crop. And so that's why we're here, and that's why I thank Patricia for bringing us here.
Excellent tweet. Sorry, it was amazing.
Thank you.
Looking around the globe, which countries would you say have taken the lead on this issue, and why do you think they have taken the lead?
It's interesting. One of the most modernized and engineering brilliant countries in the world is Germany. And right now, they're a little bit under 30% of their energy from renewables. They saw that they were in trouble, and they were incredibly reliant upon outside resources to power their grid and their homes. And so they took the lead probably 5 or 6, 10 years ago, starting with small community solar projects. they're on track to be up at 40% in the next 5 years. That's what they're headed for. Now, Germany has one of the most stable economies, although it looks like a nightmare right now. They have one of the most stable economies in Europe. And it's not a coincidence that they have such a high renewable energy standard there.
We don't have a national energy
policy
in the United States.
No.
I think it was Jimmy Carter was the last person to actually propose an energy policy. We've had CAFE standards.
That's right.
Which have actually had a major effect.
Sure.
I remember talking to executives at Texaco during one administration that was supporting this. And so Texaco started to go into it, and then the funding stopped.
Yes.
And you can't have stop and go to do this. How do you intend to get whatever administration it is committed to putting an energy policy in place? Because we have none.
We
want to talk no policy.
I think that everything's changed. It's different than it was 5 years ago. We're witnessing the decentralization of everything. Everything is being decentralized. Because of the most democratizing tool in the world, the internet. And all of a sudden, you have these social movements that are changing the world, but it's coming from the bottom up. It isn't coming from the top down. The system has been so gamed that there is no way we could do it on a policy level. NRDC is very good with fighting these things in a court. But even that system's been gained. And every year, their ability to affect change is becoming less and less vibrant. We're seeing people learn throughout the world that they actually have a voice, and together they can make change happen in a big way. And who knows what that change is going to end up being, but at least people are engaging, and I think that's the way we get there. That's what stopped hydrofracking in New York State. That's what stopped the Keystone Pipeline. These things should never have been won. I mean, they told me 4 years ago, go back to sleep, kid. You don't have a chance in the world. Gas is coming. Just go back to sleep. Go sell your place upstate. What are you, crazy, kid? It's coming. Forget about it, you know? And I stepped out and started talking to people, and all of a sudden, in 3 days, we had 60,000 signatures on a moratorium request. And that was 2 years ago.
We have time for one more question.
Oh. One little comment. It's more of a comment. It's just one voice. That's all it takes. We're not part of it. We're actually just from Maine, and I was able to come as part of the common good to bring my daughter. But it comes from one teacher talking about this and getting the kids talking about alternative energy. And Alexander, my daughter here, she's a freshman in high school, designing, going after the German thought process of using magnetism to use their power, their transportation. So it's starting at such, it's just one voice. And it was this one teacher at the school who got wind turbines up. Nobody wanted that thing. It was big, nobody knew what it was, but she got it and she got the kids involved, and now the kids are a voice for the state and they're going out internationally, and I don't know, it just takes one voice. So to hear such passion, we came here just to maybe get her to go back and say, look, this is something this is her future. She's 15.
This is the most exciting, everything I said is a downer as it is. I'm so excited. I am so hopeful.
Change.
This is, everything's, it can happen now. We have the technology to do it. And all we need to do is have people who, like us, like you, to step out and start to imagine that this is actually a possibility. You know, President Obama, God bless him, he went out there. Yes, he talked a lot about gas drilling. But what he did do also was he said, we need renewable energy. What president's ever done that, except for Jimmy Carter? But he never did it in a State of the Union address. He never did it in the State of the Union address.
Well, I think other presidents have talked about it.
They did? The way Obama did?
Stuff, yes.
All right, well, I thought that that was, in this climate, a pretty bold thing to do. It also resonated with people.
You know, there's precedents for this, politically, where there's new technology. The United States has had precedents. Europe has had precedents. Euratom, communication satellite, in which public corporations on the stock exchange, which had to make profits from new technology, but you really have to have leadership to do it. And you're going to have to have
president. You're the guy.
Yeah. We can take one more over here.
I just have one question. Yes. So what can we do to help? So I'm not a public figure.
Yes.
Great my money question. Is, you know, I'm a single girl in New York City. I have no connections to the White House, so being a New York City girl, what can I do, you know, to help? Tomorrow I wake up, and what can I do?
Claire, would you help me? Claire's our executive director. There's a lot going on right now.
Yeah, I mean, there are so many different things, and I think one thing that's so spectacular about this movement in New York, and a few of you who I've talked to have already kind of gotten that gleam in your eye where you start to follow this issue, and then all of a sudden you're running around and you're talking to people about earthquakes and solar panels and geothermal and all of these possibilities. And so I do think that there are so many different ways to get involved, and we definitely would love to have everyone sign up with us and get engaged with what we're doing with our planned Days of Action, our upcoming videos, talking about natural gas that we're going to be releasing throughout the summer. And I do think that everyone in this room can make an enormous impact writing personally to Governor Cuomo, even if it's on behalf of a neighborhood group or a civic group, but certainly there are many voices here that would go a long way. And Governor Cuomo is weighing the factors, so it's very important that we make our positions on this issue known. And he's I think, coming to this with an open mind, which is something that is really to his credit. So we're very excited to work with all of you.
If you go to Water Defense, you could see there's quite a few actions that you could do, even just signing a petition with
the governor. But,
yes. But even talking to your friends, you know, I'm sure there's some things ever passed around today that you never even thought of, you know, but just, I find just talking to people is really powerful. You'd be surprised.
And Claire, were you guys at Governor's Island for the Water Day? They have that annual Water Day at Governor's Island.
We were there. We had some tables there. There are a lot of.
Someone approached me about fracking.
Yes. Well, what's really powerful is having somebody who is a major actor and a major star. Now in the biggest, after this weekend, I understand it's going to be the fourth largest box office hit in the history of Hollywood, The Avengers. And of course, he was nominated for that wonderful movie that
Kids Are All Right. Thank you, Peter Worth, for that wonderful introduction.
And Andy, thank you so much for opening your home.
Yes. Thank you.